In my hands, I hold what I believe to be one of the most beautiful sounding tubes ever made. Originally designed for telephone amplification, this tube is comprised of only three element pieces: one filament, an input grid, and an anode output. That's right, folks. The mighty 300B. Luscious mid-range? Yes. Delicate details? All day long. Seductive emotion? Yeah, it's got the good stuff. Welcome back to New Record Day. My name is Ron. If you are into two-channel audio, consider yourself an audiophile or music enthusiast. Welcome home. Make sure you hit the subscribe button and bell notification so you know when the next video drops. In today's video, New Record Day unpacks every reason why these Manly Labs Neoclassic 300B single-ended push-pull monoblocks would be my desert island amplifiers. Now here's the deal. With the 300B tube, there are some sacrifices and trade-offs we should be chatting about. Of course, this is largely based on the amplifier's topology, but let's not get ahead of ourselves. What are those trade-offs, and what do we need to know before buying what I believe is quite possibly one of the most flexible and well-thought-out 300B monoblocks on planet Earth? And with a warm welcome back to New Record Day, that is exactly what we are going to find out. Before we get started, folks, today's video sponsor, Audio Art Cable, not only supplied all the cables used throughout my edition with the Manlys, but also has some great promos coming up for the holidays. Up through Monday the 14th, Audio Art is extending a last chance for 20% off all cables store-wide. That's right, folks, if you missed their Black Friday and Cyber Monday sales, it's not too late to take advantage of their biggest sale they have offered over the past year. Now, not only is Rob from AAC offering this great deal to the public, but he's also extended two off-the-menu deals exclusive to NRD viewers. Check it out, guys. For those interested in the crazy popular Triangle Borea Bro 2 or 3 models, or anyone interested in the R2R Sonnet Morpheus DAC, Rob has made it clear. Pause the review or make a note to reach out to him directly. He really wants to give you guys something special, so all his contact information is down below. In any event, AAC has always believed in what we are trying to do here at NRD, and we appreciate these deals and certainly appreciate the sponsorship. Thank you so much, Rob, and guys, don't forget to bookmark AAC in the links down below. Taking a look at the front of the amplifiers, there is a switch to the right which allows you to mute the amplifier, while on the left, another switch which allows you to change the amp from single-ended to push-pull configurations. While using single-ended, the amplifier is pushing 11 watts, and while in push-pull, 24 watts. Folks, this is the first thing that makes these monoblocks pretty dang unique. Most of the 300B monoblock amplifiers out there might be lucky to push 5 to 9 watts in single-ended only. While there is nothing necessarily wrong with that if you have insanely sensitive speakers, this guy opens the door to more possibility by upping its output capabilities in parallel single-ended or two tubes, and with the flick of a switch, doubling the output per channel in push-pull configurations. The Neoclassic tube topology starts with the 6SL7 input tube, 6SN7 driver tube, with of course the 300Bs right behind them serving as the power tubes. Behind the 300s, we have our first custom-made transformer from Manly. Don't worry, more on that in a minute. And beyond that transformer, there are four smokestacks, or for those technical, they are four giant rail capacitors. Now, these caps are made in America by Cornell Dublier and share the responsibility of storing a ton of energy and delivering impact and punch to the party. Beyond the caps, we have our last set of tubes, which are 5Y4 rectifiers, and last, another transformer which is also custom made by Manly. Now, in regards to the custom made transformers, these babies have to accomplish a lot of acrobats to function well in both single-ended or push-pull modes and deal with a varying amount of feedback. This is only one of the many reasons as to why Manly is doing all the work in-house in their magnetics department. Made in America is one thing, but literally making the heart of these amps in-house is a whole other level. On the back of the amp to the left, there is a mains input and power switch. To the right, there is the RCA single-ended input, and just above, the speaker output terminals, along with a switch that allows you to customize the amp to your speaker's impedance load. The first thing we need to explore is just how versatile these amps are, but at the same time, set reasonable expectations. For those that watched my Manly Snappers review, you already know I believe those particular amps are more of a straight line, no compromise tube amp that will probably drive just about any loudspeaker out there. Not only that, but they offer insane bass slam and crisp, airy top end extension, which is not easy to pull off with an all tube topology. So, it's important to note, these 300B monoblocks are not the same amplifier as the Snappers. That is to say, they sound different, and with these 300Bs, you might make a couple compromises when compared to the Snappers we love so much. But before we come to any conclusions making it sound like these are a one-trick pony, we need to explore some of the features, starting with the ability to switch from parallel single-ended to push-pull on the fly and what happens as we do so. For what it's worth, after using these amps with every speaker that I have in house over the last few months, here is my takeaway on the two best pairings I have in house. Number one. These amps in single-ended mode work amazingly well with the JR Research NX Auticas, which are rated around 94-ish dB and in easy to drive 8 ohm load. That combo will play much louder than I care to listen to. In regards to bass slam and performance, it's hard to predict because the Auticas drop off like a rock in my room around 50 Hz, but I'll say this, mid bass and what I can hear in deeper bass all sounds punchy and incredibly confident. Number two. Swapping out the NX Auticas for the Spatial Audio Sapphires, which are 92 dB sensitive, but dip down to 3.3 ohms around 50 Hz, single-ended worked fine for 90% of the music that I play, even when turning the music up again louder than I care to listen to. However, switching the amplifier to push-pull, which again you can do on the fly, did seem to bring some of the bigger dynamic swings with less effort and also proved to be a better match for these speakers overall. Anything less than 90 dB sensitive speakers, depending on their impedance ratings, can be hit or miss in my experience. But to be clear, not once with any speaker did I feel that a particular combo was a bad match per se, but at the same time, great matches for me started with speakers moving in the direction of 90 dB sensitivity or higher. So another thing that I want to discuss before we move on. The room, folks. We must take a moment and consider the thing that no one is chatting about enough. Meaning, how far are you away from the speakers, and how far are those speakers away from the walls? This will surely have a huge impact on how loud you can get away with listening. As you guys know, my room is rather large, but I also pull my speakers deep into the room using LOTS. If you're new here, that's our speaker setup guide and surely worth checking out. The room matters a lot, and the distance from you to the speaker matters. Output capabilities of amplifiers are directly tied to your environment, which will ultimately determine what you can or can't get away when considering these monoblocks. Shoot Manly an email or give them a call if you want to discuss the specifics, and I'm sure they can take it from here. The second thing that makes these amplifiers so darn unique and special is the ability to change negative feedback in either topology. And again, you can do this on the fly. The best way I can describe the negative feedback knob is, it's a how much do you want to cry knob. I know that sounds a little silly, but it's true. In the event where you want to cry because the mid-range is so darn sweet, simply reduce the negative feedback by turning the knob down. In the event where you want to cry less and move more in a linear or solid state direction, turn the negative feedback up or higher. Now, that's not to say this amp ever sounds solid state, even when maxing out the negative feedback, but I'll say this. The top end sounds slightly brighter or closer to what you might expect with a detail-centric amplifier, or again, a trait you hear with solid state amplification. P.S. I didn't cry once while listening to 300Bs, unless it was Diana Krall, because heaven knows, that nonsense will make anyone with good taste in music cry. Nope, that one's gonna ruffle some feathers. That was a bad idea. So the first thing that I wanted to explore is whether or not these amps can move in the direction of what I love so much about the Snappers. Those amps are a no-compromise straight-line amp and is the kind of amp topology that does celebrate crisp and airy highs without the butt. Firing up Ben Howard's Every Kingdom with the NXauticas on deck, I tried the amp set with no negative feedback, and after bawling like a baby at how good the mid-band sounded, I started adding negative feedback 1 dB at a time and ended with the knob maxed out. Now, the gain reduces as you add negative feedback, so it's important to compensate by increasing the volume. After contemplating things for a while and even going back and forth experimenting, here are my thoughts of all things in the time domain. Air does exist with these amplifiers as long as you are willing to spend time exploring the dial. It's interesting to note that while I thought maxing out the negative feedback was the quickest way to introduce the most top end, that was sorta kinda not totally what I experienced.
What?
I know. It's complicated like all things in hi-fi. It's like this, folks. That knob does seem to be a balancing act, and what I discovered is top end air and extension seem to sound right for me, starting as soon as 5 or 6 on the dial. Knowing these are 1 decibel increments, that means applying 5 or 6 decibels of negative feedback gave me the goods with the Auticas in my room with my source and my preamp, meaning your results might vary. In any event, cymbal hits sounded as they should, and we had the initial attack, and depending on the volume, enough yeah to wake up the neighbors and truly rock out. So wait a second here. We're talking about 11 watts. Did I just say a single-ended 300B amplifier pushing the Auticas has enough you-know-what to rock out in cymbal town? I sure did, Susie Sissy Pants. Feel free to write it down in a Christmas card and send it to Grandma Sally. Even more, past that initial hit, we have decay, presence, and yes, folks, we got it. We got the air. Am I insane to say that you can hear air in a cymbal hit? No. And once you have heard it, you quickly realize this is where some tube amps can do this, and it's largely based on topology, the guts, and yes, folks, the transformer. I am 100% convinced that these amps can dish it out because everything I just mentioned, and it's one of the things that is directly tied to the iron behind tubes. While negative feedback is applied to the Neo 300s, you better believe me when I say this amp can produce ambience that is both audible and an absolute pleasure to listen to. On the other hand, and again, what makes these amps so darn unique is, what if you back off the negative feedback or dial in more tissues? Well, sure, you will have less of this ambience I'm rambling about, but at the same time, you also gain some delicacy in upper mid-range and below. Depending on the dial, you can even move things in the more traditional, warmish campfire lit from within character of classic tube designs. Staying focused on what this has to do with top and extension of the 300Bs, I think the negative feedback can ultimately be used as a precision tone control for top-end air and extension. Swapping out the NX Auticas for the Sapphires and flicking the switch to push-pull, almost everything I said about how the amp responds remains the same. If anything, the biggest changes that I heard are probably due to the Auticas being a little more detail-centric on top and being completely open baffle from top to bottom. So, air and extension of all things top end stand out a little more with the Auticas than they do with the Sapphires. With the Sapphires, as I mentioned in my review, the top end is very natural sounding. The Sapphire tweeter will never call attention to itself, and with the 300Bs running the show, this was one of the most balanced top ends I have ever spent time with. Period. Going through track after track or album after album, I realized this would be the combo for those who might enter listening fatigue or can live without every single pop, sneeze, or chair squeak being thrown their way. Also, like the Auticas, the Manleys took no issue with smacking the Sapphires around. Trying anything ranging from AC/DC to Metallica, I quickly realized that 25 watts of push-pull muscle made by the fine folks at Manly isn't the same thing of trying to crack cymbals with Grandpa's tube amplifier. Summing up the top end of the Manly 300Bs, I'll say this. It's quite frankly whatever you want it to be. As the title suggests, these could be my desert island amplifiers because I know how versatile they really are. If I'm applying negative feedback because I want all the top end glory I could ask for, I can do that. If I want to relax it a little more, I can do that by simply dialing back and reducing negative feedback, and at the same time, gain some interesting things happening in other areas. So yeah, looks like it's time to chat about what that might be. When it comes to the mid-band performance of the Manleys, for those that have heard great 300B amps, this is where we will already agree. There is nothing else quite like it. Specifically, with the human voice and all things acoustic, these amps will provide an intimate, up-close, and personal gateway that connects you with the performance. Again, depending on where the negative feedback is dialed in, it's almost as if all the other amps out there have a dirty window that you have been looking through. With the Manleys, and when it comes to their mid-band performance, that window is squeaky clean. Now, I want to talk about something that will most likely get me in trouble, but hey, this is NRD and that's how we do things from time to time. That last comment about the squeaky clean window, I fully understand that in the event where this review makes its way to some of our scientific measurement friends, they would most likely have a chuckle and say something to the effect of, "There is no place for tubes in hi-fi, and this clown has no idea what he's saying because he's actually hearing distortion." In other words, how can the window be squeaky clean when distortion is involved? This is actually a fair criticism, but it's also looking at one tree while ignoring the beautiful evergreen forest that surrounds you. Folks, tubes by nature are actually quite linear devices. Also, the distortion they introduce is not the same distortion we are talking about when it comes to most solid-state designs. Well, I'm not going to tackle this from a technical standpoint, as I fully admit I'm not qualified. I will politely reply to the possible future response of, "But you're hearing distortion," by saying, "I know, and it sounds beautiful." So I think the Manleys' mid-band performance is surely detailed, but not in a, "Hey, hey, look at me over here," not anything like that. I describe it more like being able to track the harmonic decay of every vocal and instrument in ways that sounds natural and realistic. This is the key, folks. I believe it's less about cramming detail down your throat and more about bringing to life music in ways that many amps just don't or can't do. Even more, a lot of this level of detail is found in space, where we start chatting about how holographic and three-dimensional an amp can or cannot sound. Now, in the case of the Manley 300Bs, three-dimensional is the building blocks of their DNA. They were born to do it, and they do it very well. Any well-recorded material with properly placed loudspeakers will bring the vocalists out in front of the mic. You will easily be able to hear every precise thing they say or sing about, but you will also have an idea of the distance between them, the microphone, and whatever is close to them, both forward and back, left to right. You can close your eyes and know without a doubt where the singer is and if that singer might be holding an acoustic guitar. Are they standing or sitting will easily be determined, and how hard or soft they play will be easy to track without seeing them. As they play that acoustic guitar, this becomes the anchor, and the distance from the sound hole to the neck of the guitar is also heard, and from there, you can trace around the vocalist's arms, making out their torso and head. This level of intimacy is what the mid-band is all about with these amplifiers, and if this sounds like voodoo nonsense, I'm gonna say this being serious. I honestly feel sorry for you, and I mean it. You are missing out on some unbelievably amazing experiences, and getting there begins with proper speaker placement, the right room, acoustic treatment, the right combination of gear, and in my case, quite frankly, some of the most amazing tube amplifiers I have ever spent time with. As we round the corner to bass performance, I'm going to temper expectations, but also celebrate the fact that these amps honestly surprise me. As I mentioned before, the Audicas drop off in my room around 50 Hertz, so let's not spend a ton of time chatting about those. Instead, the Spatial Sapphires play confident down to the low 30s, which is pushing into subwoofer territory in a quick hurry. Actually, you know what? You guys have asked for it, and I'm going to deliver. You old school New Record Day fans ready? I'm about to make you really happy. Okay, here it goes. 1, 2, 3. Dropping the needle on Bella Flex, Cosmic Hippo, and giving the Sapphires juice from the 300Bs, I was first and foremost surprised by the fact that we had enough bass to shake off Sarah's clothes in a quick hurry. Granted, the bass, while not the tightest I've heard, still hit with enough authority that I quickly realized this is not only on par with the LTAZ-10 we reviewed, but seemed to hit even harder, making this one heck of a compelling option after all. As the track played and I listened carefully, sacrificing some of the grip and speed of solid-state muscle power would be the only trade-off that I noticed in deep, meaningful bass. However, I am reminded we are asking a lot knowing that dip of 3.3 ohms is right at 50 Hertz with the Sapphires. So, for those with easier to drive loads and deep bass capabilities, folks, time to rejoice and get that finger resting on the checkout button. Now, keep in mind, just like our treble impressions, bass performance does seem to be tied to negative feedback as well. In the Bella Fleck example I just gave, this was with negative feedback applied and being specific sitting at 9 decibels on the amp. What I think is interesting and something you guys would certainly want to explore, bass speed, grip, and authority all seem to be linked to negative feedback as well. I noticed with less negative feedback, things warmed up in the mid-bass and lower mid-range and seemed to sound thicker throughout the bass frequencies. So again, while these amps won't wake up every single speaker on earth and knock down every wall with their bass capabilities, there does seem to be a lot more performance waiting than you might expect when paired with the right speakers while experimenting with the amp settings. Now, bass output is just one aspect of the hi-fi party, and don't think for a second it's the most important or only thing worth chatting about. Texture and tone in bass is often neglected, and what I noticed with the Manly 300Bs is just how much resolution and detail they are able to excavate in all things bass. When listening to something like Ray Brown's Solar Energy, or even the newly discovered Beyond the Double Bass by Renaud Garcia-Fons, if I'm saying that right, it's clear these 300Bs not only bring out these sometimes hard to hear resonances and details in the upright bass, but also does it in the same manner as the mid-range. Meaning, the player's bass is in the room and has actual 3D-like dimension. The weight, and dare I say density, of the bass sounds real. Not like a silly toy being played from cheap and cheesy mid-fi gear. No, folks, I can close my eyes and again hear the cavity of the bass resonate, and from within the body, complex changes in the notes being perfectly rendered without smearing together or sounding anything reminiscent to a well fart. Just like the top-end response, the bass performance of these amps is very customizable, and in the end, with the right speakers, will lead to touchdowns in all things hi-fi. Manly knows that having good iron behind those tubes is one of the biggest factors to making this work, and this is the reason they are not interested in buying Billy Bob's transformers down the street at a fraction of the price they pay for doing it in-house. I doubt Ivana would mind me saying they are obsessed with this aspect of their amps, and having heard her mention they have spent time listening to many variations of different transformers with different spices thrown into the pot, they know the recipe for success. Now, as noted, and again tempering expectations, solid state is hard to beat when it comes to speed, grip, and bass authority. I do believe that is a compromise one would make if they move in this direction, and that compromise is lessened when sliding over to the snappers as an example. However, as a conclusion, the Manly 300Bs are no slouch, and I'm positive enough to put my credibility on the line that matched with the right speakers, no one in their right mind would ever complain with what these babies bring to the table in all things bass performance. Keeping this short and sweet without repeating myself, these guys take their place with the kings of all things soundstage. While I'd agree this is a trait that most tube amplifiers possess, how much air and ambience they bring to the party is largely based on the amp's design and topology. Like I said before, using the negative feedback and appropriate pairings with speakers will pave the way to the most realistic performance in the room you will most likely ever hear. Is it that good, honestly? Honestly, it is. As I mentioned before, I have spent months listening to a wide range of speakers with these, and while the Auticas and Sapphires made the final cut, the one thing I'll say is every single speaker I had connected to these amps were able to disappear better than any other amp I have ever had in house. Holographic and transparency is what these do, and they do it with ease. Folks, what more can I say? 5-year warranty and proudly made in America is probably the last push some might need to pull the trigger. As for me, I personally hate to end this review because it means my time with these beautiful amplifiers has come to an end. I will pack these up and ship them back to Chino, California with a note that says, please hold for Ron. Mark my words, while I'm not in a position to own these amps at this time, there will come a day, sometime in the future, where Ivana's phone will buzz and on the other end will be Ron from New Record Day. After a quick catch up and small talk, I will politely ask for my amplifiers back, and those amplifiers will probably be my last.